Okay, good morning. It's certainly a pleasure to be here, and I am really thankful to Dr. Ramirez Leyva and to Rita Mondragon for inviting me, because it gave me the incentive to take a look at the connection between my field of study of information overload and your field of libraries that has always been close to my heart. Okay, the reason I'm here is because obviously we're looking at where libraries should go in this new age of changes and so on. But the key component of all these changes is information overload. And any discussion of the future and success and survival of libraries has to take information overload into account. So I came here to share with you my thoughts about where these two areas are connected. So, just to explain why a nice physicist like me is an expert of information overload, I spent most of my life working at Intel as an engineer and manager, and in 1994, Intel gave all its employees access to email for the first time, and in less than a year, email overload exploded in our faces. It was terrible, and nobody had expected it, of course. It was completely new. And I was in a position to decide to do something about it. I started looking into the problem and developing solutions. And apparently I did it okay, because in a few years the press took notice and Fast Company magazine published an interview with me. And they put my email at the interview. So I was overloaded by contacts from about 100 organizations that wanted to know what I was doing. And this included corporations and governments, and the churches and military organizations and universities and schools. Everybody wanted to know, because everybody was suffering the same problem. So I started talking to these people and collaborating, and 10 years ago we started up the Information Overload Research Group that I chair. And you can see our internet address here. And we want to go there because there is a resource center with useful information here. I also post my own website, where I have a blog where I express my views on this subject. And first I want to talk more in general about the changes in the knowledge landscape. And I point you to this gentleman here, who is one of the people of your profession a few hundred years ago. He's proliferating knowledge by copying books. And I ask you, what would happen if this guy had a time machine and came right here now and asked me, what can I tell him about our progress? What have we got today that is interesting about information access? And I would have to do this. I would show him this. And I would say, here, we have this device that fits in my pocket. And this gives me access to the entire body, of the entire knowledge of the entire human race. And what most of us do is we use it to argue with people we don't know, and to look at funny photos of cats. Now, this is a nice joke that I found online, of course, but it also captures the triumph and the tragedy of our subject, because technology has made incredible progress. I know, I'm a technologist, I love it, but behavior and culture, of course, are much slower to adapt, and people are not making use of even a fraction of the intellectual capabilities that this gives to them to expand their knowledge and so on. And you guys have in your libraries and through your libraries treasures beyond belief. You have to compete with the cats to get people to pay notice. Here's another historical thing. I'm into history because my wife happens to be a historian. She studied the Mediterranean world around the 15th century. So I get to see a lot of original documents. And here's a document. This document is from the protocols of the Spanish Inquisition. It is an inventory of all the goods in the house of somebody that they arrested. This poor guy didn't finish well, but the Inquisition was very bureaucratic, so they had to list everything they confiscated. And I point your attention to this slide. It says, item 24, Petsy Delivery. He has 24 books in his house. And this guy is not a professor or a lawyer. This is a regular middle-class citizen, the fact that he has 24 books in his house is unbelievable. It was very expensive. People didn't have that. So this guy was intellectually rich, really. And I point out to you that if he had 48 books instead of 24, he would be twice as rich and twice as happy, because more knowledge is better. Knowledge is power. Today, of course, if you have 300 emails in your inbox, it's a disaster. But if you have 600 emails, you wish you were there. Right? Meaning, what happened is information now left the paradigm of more is better completely. I know how to fix it, you know. I studied electronics, but I'm not allowed to open it now. So the user base is, of course, also changing. You have the millennials, you have the whatever letter we give to the next generation. And yes, they are digital natives, and yes, they are connected, and they were born into this, and they should be very happy in this environment. But they have the attention span of a goldfish. None of these people is going to come into your library and ask for a copy of War and Peace. And that is a problem, because you do need to get these people who are the next customers to appreciate War and Peace. You need to get them to appreciate knowledge and books, and paying attention to information and to knowledge. And in doing so, you're competing not only with the cats, but also with TED videos and with Khan Academy, and with a lot of valid online resources that go around you and make these people feel that they might not need you. And the information is exploding. Now, the quantities are impressive. We have a lot of these data all over the place. Every day, more this is created in the entire history and so on. And I don't even read them to know these things. And there are even people that study this more seriously. For instance, a few years ago, I was invited to speak at a conference in the University of California that was called How Much Information. Now, they were interested in data like you see here. This is from their proceedings. And so there are so many billions of hours of consuming information and so many zillions of bytes and megabytes and so on. And all the lectures in the conference were about this, except for one, which was mine. I talked about a completely different thing, which resonates very well with what Professor Pisanti said yesterday. I told him that the quantity doesn't matter. Why doesn't it matter? Because all this information is stored in silicon, and silicon is made of sand. And we have enough sand, we don't care if we have to store a lot of information. What we care about is the value density of the megabytes. How much each megabyte is valuable to us people. In fact, I called my lecture, all megabytes are not created equal. Some of them are useful, some of them are harmful, some of them are both, depending on the time and user and context. And here I show you two graphs. This shows the value of accessible information. And that levels out. If I have access to 20 encyclopedias, another encyclopedia is not really valuable to me at all. But the value of access to information is this one. And as you see, it goes up, and then it stops, and then it goes down, and then it goes negative. Because if I have 1,000 emails, the next email is actually bad for me, because it confuses me and dilutes my inbox, so I don't see the important ones that went before. So that is what I'm saying here. Information can actually get to negative. And in that lecture, I analyzed maybe 10 different factors that can change the value of a megabyte of information. Here I want to focus on one. This is use model expectation. What we expect people to do with information. Consider Wikipedia. Wikipedia, in case you didn't know, is about 10 terabytes. Just the text, not the pictures. Meanwhile, nobody is complaining. 10 terabytes or no, everybody loves it. But if you have 300 emails in your inbox, which comes to maybe 10 megabytes, which is a million times less than Wikipedia, you feel huge overload and you are unhappy and depressed. What's the difference? That nobody expects you to read all of Wikipedia. Wikipedia works in pull mode. When you want to learn something, you go and pull it. Email works in push mode. It is pushed in your face from the server, and anybody in the world can send you an email and it will be added to push mode. That's push mode. And push mode is bad for us, but unfortunately the users are addicted to it. They are addicted to checking mail, they are addicted to getting onto distribution lists because of the fear of missing out, almost, we call it, and because of the way the brain works. There is enough research showing that this behavior of checking your inbox and your Facebook and so on is related to actual chemical activity in the brain, similar to what you see in people gambling in Las Vegas, for example. So that is unfortunate for us. Now, I was asked to talk about big data in this context, and I must point out that big data is not information overload. Big data is the exact opposite of information overload. Because big data does not mean, oh my God, lots of information. Big data means a specific methodology developed by computer scientists that allows you to analyze huge data sets of millions and billions of data points through algorithms that can extract correlations and predictions from them. And if necessary, also we have visualization tools to allow us to see it better. So basically, what we are seeing here is not information overload, but the computer, which is to blame for the overload maybe, coming to help us by getting fed all this information. And the computer doesn't complain about the overload. And it makes the information small enough and focused enough for us humans to be able to consume it. And not only that, but the more overload we give the computer, the better the results. So, big data example, here is a nice map of New York City. And what we see here is the data set of every photo of New York posted on Flickr, which is a huge data set, millions of photos that are tagged by location and time. And the correlation the computer does is it correlates the location to whether the photographer is a New York citizen or a tourist. How does it know? By analyzing over time how many times this person posted photos. If you did it for 1 week and then stopped, he's a tourist, right? And the visualization is obvious, the tourists are red, the locals are blue. This is extremely valuable if you are a city planner or if you are a tourist industry person and you need to know where the tourists are, and where the citizens are going, and where they meet each other, and so on. No human being could do this from this data without these methodologies, of course. Now, this technique is extremely powerful. Does miracles, it can predict the future, some would say. A good example is a young woman in Israel called Dr. Kira Radinsky that is doing extremely well these days. And in her doctorate, she developed the ability to read the entire 150 years content of the New York Times from the past, throw in all of Wikipedia, and look for interesting things. And one of these interesting things is the fact that if you have a drought, dry year, and then 2 years later, you have a rainstorm, then you will get an outbreak of cholera if the country is poor. Now, nobody would have seen that already in the New York Times, but computers can correlate different years. And in fact, she predicted the outbreak of cholera in 2010 in Cuba, after 130 years that they didn't see cholera at all. She predicted wars, but she does interesting things. The reason she's doing well, other than the satisfaction of being extremely intelligent, is that she started a company around this and bought surveys for $40 million. Because people are willing to pay for knowing the future. The same tool has very scary possibilities, though. Look at this quote here. Today in the United States, we have somewhere around 4,000 or 5,000 data points on every single citizen, it says. So they can model the personality of every adult in the United States. Now, this was not said by the head of the KGB. This was said by the CEO of Cambridge Analytica, which is the company that put itself at the service of Trump and of Brexit in the UK. And when they know 5,000 things about every individual, all legal information, all open information, they know that individual better than his own mother knows him. So they know what propaganda to send every individual specifically to change his mind. It is scary. It gets scarier to remember the movie Minority Report. Because the ability to predict who will commit a crime is not even science fiction anymore. We're seeing war along those lines. So, it will be interesting. Next, I want to talk about information overload in general. We'll get to libraries later. This is a beast of many heads. It affects many areas. There is information overload in the knowledge workplace. by which I mean people who basically live inside the computer. Years ago, I would say this is people that don't drive a truck. Today, it includes people that drive a truck. Then there is information overload in social media. There is medical practice in other disciplines. There is intelligence as in anti-terrorism. There is news consumption as in fake news. All these areas have their own types of information overload. And I will talk about a few of them. Starting with my own specialty of law in data screen offices, this is me and you, there are two problems with this, two components to the problem. One is email overload, and you know the numbers. And the other is interruptions, which you don't know perhaps, but this is the worst problem of the two. It takes more time, actually, and because of the time it takes the brain to switch after the interruption. The data from studies at the University of California, actual observation of knowledge workers in the wild, they stop what they're doing and start doing something different every 3 minutes on average, all the time. So they can't think for more than 3 or 5 minutes about anything. The price we pay for this is terrible. One analyst company in the US analyzed it and came with $1 trillion every year, just the lost time for American industry. Because people lose about 1 day a week, and I study it too. It is 2 hours a week on completely unnecessary emails, and 6 hours a week on the switching time of the brain from the interruptions. There's also damage to creative thinking. People can't think in this way. Somebody called it a continuous partial attention. And that means that the research shows that they make more mistakes, they are less creative, the more interruptions they have, we see that they're less creative. Terrible things happen there too. There is disruption of organizational processes. For instance, meetings. Now, a meeting is where people, intelligent people hopefully, come together to put their brains together to reach decisions based on joint thinking. In today's meetings, everybody has this glazed look in their eyes looking at their screen. Nobody listens at all. So the meetings, which are a key part of the corporate existence, are completely useless. And there is, of course, the harm to personal and family quality of life, with people doing email around the clock, in the bedroom, on vacation, during breakfast, people don't see their children. It is extremely sad. So that's the damage. If you want more information on this, I have some articles I wrote that quantify and give the pointers to the literature on my website. And the question is, why are we doing this to each other? For example, why would an intelligent person sit up at 2 in the morning and send emails that they know nobody will read? They know, they don't read them themselves. And this is not because they're stupid. This is because they know exactly what they're doing. Because of fear. Because of mistrust. Because of all the things that every organization will tell you they don't have. For example, they send the emails because they're afraid that their boss will not value them if they don't see them active at 2 in the morning. Or they send email to cover themselves in case something goes wrong. Or they send email because they want to be in on the action. Right? And the point is everybody would gain if everybody sent less email. But this is never going to happen because nobody dares to be the first one to cut back. Because this game in the autocracy, in the corporate environment, certainly, is a zero-sum game. He gets promoted, I don't get promoted. And this immediately shows that this is a kind of prisoner's dilemma. So the conclusion here is that effective solutions to organizational information overload must come from the top, because they require a culture change. They require changing the payoff table of the prisoner's dilemma. And that can only be done by the man at the top. Now, regarding solutions in this space, there is rich set of solutions over the last 15, 20 years to develop a lot of things. I put together a catalog of all these solutions 2 years ago. I came to 160. There are solutions that change the organizational culture, that make different use of messaging, that eliminate email altogether in rare cases, to replace it with other modes of behavior. There are software automation tools that help you deal with your mail. There are personal coping strategies which teach you how to manage your time with your inbox and your email. And there is a promising trend because these days we see more solutions that use artificial intelligence to help you cope with your incoming load. For example, if you're going to a meeting in 5 minutes, you can ask your device and it will tell you, look, there are 500 messages, but these two are important right now because they are related to what you're going to do in this meeting. How does it know? Because it's artificially intelligent. Obviously, there is a technology behind it. And that's another case of the computer stepping in to protect us from the damage that it has done us through all these tools. I don't have time to teach you how to cope with your inbox, but I will give you the one tip as a bonus that is the most important and the simplest. And it is, you should read your inbox in 3 to 5 times each day. Depending on your routine and your preference, maybe 1 hour in the morning and 1 in the evening, maybe just after lunch, which is what I do, because then my brain is slowest. But choose times and stick to them every single day, and don't look at your email at all at other times. Which means you must turn off all the alerts, the beeps and the pop-ups and the you've got mail. You don't want to know you've got mail. You know you've got mail. You've got mail all the time. What you want to do is go look at the mail when you want to look at it. Right? Now, it takes some courage to do it, but don't worry. If your house will burn, they will call you on your phone. Don't have to look at your email every minute. Tim Ferriss is a productivity guru, and he says this one habit can revolutionize your life. And I really stand that this is true. So go and do it. Oh, we are going forward or backward? We're going backward. Regarding social media, this is a newer phenomenon, but of course with all these channels coming in, people are using the addiction to check all of them, and it gets bad. I can share the story of a student. I was a mentoring student in college, and this girl comes to me and says she has a terrible problem. What is the problem? She's checking her Facebook all the time. Terrible. So I say, what's the problem? I mean, so you don't have to see all the sandwiches that your friends ate, right? She says, it's not that. It's not cats. What she was doing, she had an extremely carefully assembled set of groups she wanted to check because the subject was interesting, and of RSS feeds from blogs that she found interesting, and head channels. It was all well curated, and she had 2,000 of these channels. So I said, okay, so throw out 90%, and you're good. She said, how can she throw them out? She took so much intellectual effort into assembling. So, it's a problem. In medical practice, we have serious problems. First, the doctors are forced by the organizations to do everything on the computer, so they look at the computer instead of you most of the time. And even though they look at the computer all the time, they still have no hope of reading even a tiny fraction of the new journal articles in their field of specialization. We know that. So what happens is medicine runs forward with new solutions. You come to the specialist with a serious illness and the doctor doesn't know what has been discovered on the other side of the world 2 months ago that could cure you. And you die. In case you didn't know, medical errors are the third cause of death in the United States after heart disease and cancer. Okay? And this is what happened to medical errors. The solutions in this space also involve computers, and they definitely employ big data techniques. Because there's all this data, all these millions and millions of findings and articles. One thing we're seeing is IBM Watson. That's the computer that won the game of Jeopardy, the TV show. Which is, a TV show, but it is actually a huge achievement in artificial intelligence. IBM changed the role of this computer, and now it's assisting doctors to diagnose based on patient histories and symptoms. And what it does is it looks at what the doctor says, and then it reads or uses a database it has of all the knowledge in all those tens of millions of articles, and it identifies what is right to tell the doctor to consider. And we also have Semantic Scholar, which is like Google Scholar. It looks at the journal articles, but unlike Google Scholar, it actually looks at the content and the connections and who copied from who and who is smarter than who, and it makes sense of it and recommends it. And it now has 40 million articles. Also, they are saying that this tool is being evolved to where it will identify what's missing. For example, what promising research should be performed that the existing articles are overlooking? As to intelligence gathering, the most canonical example is 9/11. We have these guys from Egypt learning to fly huge planes and asking questions about large buildings, and nobody notices, right? Because it's a needle in the haystack. What we're seeing there certainly is going in the direction of big data, although we're not told everything that the CIA is doing. But this is an academic study that was done after they caught Bin Laden. And what it does is it takes all the articles in all the newspapers in the world that mention Bin Laden during the years that everybody thought he was hiding in Afghanistan, and is plotting connections between all the locations mentioned in these articles. And if you examine this closely, you realize that the guy is not in Afghanistan, he's in Abbottabad in Pakistan. Well, you don't know the city, but you have a radius, a small radius around the city, that all the information somehow converges on. So that's an example, and I don't know if the CIA used this or not, but we're on, but that's where things are going in this way. Now I want to go closer to you and talk about the risks and challenges of information overload in academia and in libraries. I have a friend, Professor David Levy, in the State University of Washington, who has made a study of it, which is field. He looks at what he calls no time to think. In fact, if you Google David Levy and no time to think, you will find a very nice lecture he has in video about this. And what he's looking at is what happens to the interactions between academics, knowledge, and itself. And he finds that there is a big problem. First of all, the professors and the students have such a huge overload that they can't do their thing. They can't stop to think. Consider Isaac Newton. Newton is sitting under a tree, right, waiting for the apple to fall. And the question nobody is asking is, what is he doing under a tree during work hours? Now, what he's doing is his job, because he is a natural philosopher. His job is to sit out there and think for days and months and years until the apple falls. Today, he would have his smartphone beep every 3 minutes, right? And he wouldn't know why apples fall at all. Another problem, though, is that the professors and the students can't talk to each other anymore, because they're so busy, and because they're always on their devices. They have, you know, people sitting at the same table, sending each other messages on their devices, right? So in this environment, the classic paradigm of academic study is gone. Think of Socrates sitting with his students, talking to them, asking them questions, annoying them, you know, inspiring them. They ask him. None of this can happen when everybody is doing email or attending to their Facebook all the time. So this is a problem, and in fact, just having a smartphone is enough to give you problems for a student. Two students of mine made an experiment. They took a classroom in college and they divided it into one half of the class had smartphones on the table, like they always do, and the other half didn't. And then they did a surprise test at the end of the class on the subject that was being taught. And they found a difference of 23 points out of 100 in the average grade. People with smartphones were not paying attention and they were not learning. So that's what this is doing in academia. Oops. Sorry about that. Here we go. Now I get closer to you guys in libraries. And I want to look at the move to digital. Now everybody loves moving to digital for two reasons. It allows everybody in the world to see the stuff. And it costs money in a sense because you don't need to store paper. So management loves it. Unfortunately, there is a price to it. And here you see my wife some years ago doing the research on the Mediterranean history, sitting next to a big volume of documents. Just to give you an idea of what this is about, you see here, this word says Ferdinandus, etc. Etc. means king of Aragon in Sicily and Sardinia and so on. And Ferdinandus is King Ferdinand the Catholic. And the year is 1492. He didn't write it. He's one of the endless bureaucratic people that were working for it. But this is from the royal, you know, bureaucracy of the kingdom of Aragon. And the point is, it's perfectly legible. Even I can read it without any effort. And it's 500 years old. And thanks into the same room in the ark that we were sitting, comes someone like this young lady with this beautiful shiny notebook and starts typing. And I say to her, I say, look, this paper has been there 500 years and I can read it. What she is typing, nobody will be able to read in 50 years. She'd be lucky if she can read it in 10 years. And if you don't believe me, look at these. How many of you have a pile of these at home? Can you read them? This was what, 15 years ago? 20? The problem, of course, is that the digital is supposed to last forever, but technology changes, the media changes, everything changes. And we are losing a lot here. First, because when we digitize old documents, we need the actual image and picture, because, you know, there's dirt and spots and they're yellow, and many of the digital versions are not as good as the original or as in quality microfilm. So we are losing some words we can no longer read. And even new documents leave us at risk. Because there is a crisis. This is a quote from a director at Seagate Corporation. They make stones, right? They make hard disks. And he says there is a coming crisis because the cost of migrating this digital information forward in large libraries is so high that even the United States, that is to be a pretty rich country, cannot afford it anymore. So if you digitize your information, throw out the original, that's it. In 10 or 20 years, you will need to invest millions to move it forward from the cloud to the moon or whatever they do then. And it will be impossible to do if you don't have the money. And you know, yeah, you will go to the management of the university and you say, come on, this is the library of all the articles on the nose of the common rat from between 1920 and 1930. How can we not invest in that? And the manager for civil. So, there is also another problem here. Consider why my wife can study how people lived in the 15th century. It's because they wrote letters, documents. Because everybody wrote letters, right? I have a box which this big, you know, of letters and photographs that I inherited from my parents when they passed away recently. They go back to the middle of the 19th century because when their parents passed away, they gave their letters to them and they gave them to me. I'm actually trying to make some order in this and produce a kind of a PDF that I can give to the next generations so at least my children and grandchildren can enjoy it. But all that information won't exist for our grandchildren because we don't write letters at all. It's all digital, it's all on Facebook. If you think anyone is going to see your Facebook in 100 years, right? And that means we're living a black hole in the historical record, both for historians and for our own grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And that's an interesting thought, and I don't think many people are worried about it. But this is the information age, and never did people destroy information as fast as possible. So now let's talk about the role of libraries specifically. Now here is an interesting analogy that I got from my friend, Professor Yesha Sivan of Tel Aviv University Business School. I talked to a lot of professors and students before coming to talk to you. And he gave me this analogy, since he thought of it some years ago. He says libraries are like the gas stations on the information superhighway. And then he said, remember that the gas station is not only about dispensing gasoline. And that's true. If you drive along private night and you see this station in the distance, you know that in addition to gas, you're going to have a store where you can buy things. You're going to have a mechanic if you need to look at your engine. You're going to have maps and directions. You're going to have a coffee shop to relax in. All these other roads that have nothing to do with gas. And I think that what we need to do when we're talking about the role of libraries in the future is to look and identify the roles that the university library can adopt that are not about dispensing knowledge on people. So, one role is to help users survive the information. Now, before this century, the image of the library in our minds was very serene, right? It's like a temple on a mountain. You go there to a shrine of knowledge. college, and you sit peacefully and you look at the books, and you become better, which is all very nice. But today the information is a tsunami, and the role of the library is not on the shrine or the mountain, it's more like this railroad. The job of the library should be to protect users from the information they don't need, don't want, or they can do them harm. Fake information and just the low quality information. And the point here is I want people, the librarians, to do this in person, in the library. When I guide students doing their projects, I always tell them, forget your online searches. Go to the library, talk to a real human librarian. Because these people have magic. And it's true, there are students in Google, but a professional librarian has tools and access to databases, knowledge and experience that ordinary mortals can't even dream of. So we need them to do this for the people. Of course, we need them also to guide them and protect them from getting too much of it, and to help them identify the fake and low-value information. And I want to make the point that this requires librarians that are content experts, in addition to the new breed of librarians that are technology geeks. Right? Technology geeks, it's kind of natural to hire them. It's more modern, they cost less probably, and they can fix all the computers when they break down. If you have one, you fix this one. However, we also need people with the deep and wide knowledge. If you have a history library, you need a librarian that studies history. If you have a mathematics library, you need a librarian that has at least, you know, first degree in mathematics. Because they need to advise the students why they should look at this book and not at that book, and where in the book exactly they ought to read, right? And I am a bit concerned that we are beginning to lose those content experts, especially since we have a generation of older librarians that have been there for decades that are really experts. And it's hard to replace them, and I'm not sure everybody is making the effort. Just a thought, of course, I made you. Another role is to help create better sciences for the students. And this means teach them to think, which is what they don't have time to do, and educate them in how to themselves do online searches and how to find the information, because the professors should be doing this or too busy reading their email. And I think libraries should be the focus of where you learn how to do all the stuff that I teach, you know, the coping skills, how to manage your inbox, how to deal with email. Because librarians are ideal to do this job. And in fact, a few of universities where this is happening, at least libraries are making the online resources like guides on how to do this. And I would love to see them also do face-to-face sources. It would get them in touch with the students and probably connect them and keep them more relevant. And in this context, I want to mention one important skill, which is the skill be skeptical and not believe anything. Because today everybody believes Google, we heard yesterday Google is God, and Google has an algorithm. The algorithm is terribly biased. First, actually, it's good for you. It's biased to give you what it thinks you want to see. Right? For instance, now, in my hotel, I Google things, and I get the results page, and all the text is in Spanish. Because it thinks I'm Mexican. Right? Because it knows I'm here. It knows everything, right? 5,000 data points. But I'm not. I mean, you know, I can understand some Spanish because I speak Italian, but still, I would rather not have it do that. But it does what it wants. For me, for, because, you know, children, it's all for me. And what happens if you look for information? Let's say I ask Google, who invented penicillin? And you get this box, already summarized. Penicillin invented 1928, Alexander Fleming. And we all know the story, how he had this petri dish and this piece of mold fell from the air. Famous story that's been since. The only problem with it, it isn't true. I mean, it happened, but it's not true that he invented it. Actually, back in the 19th century, a number of scientists discovered the same thing, including one that cured sick laboratory animals, including sending papers in. Louis Pasteur knew that he could use mold to cure animals. But Google doesn't tell you that. Thinks this is good for you, this isn't good. It's not even difficult to find. There is a Wikipedia article about penicillin, and there's another Wikipedia article about the history of the discovery of penicillin. But Google doesn't send you there. And even if you are a little skeptical and look at five or six search results, and they all agree. What people don't realize is that they agree because they all copied each other or all copied the same source. And it's easy to detect that if you know what you're doing. So this is one thing that I really would like to see libraries educate people to do. Be skeptical and to dig and find the real truth behind the popular story. Another role, of course, we've seen in many talks yesterday, libraries are becoming more like Starbucks, libraries give space. This quote is from a student who happens to be my niece about Tel Aviv University Library. She says, there are quiet rooms for self-study, like the left picture, and there are rooms for team study, the other picture, and there is a room with beanbags and sofas for sleeping. Good idea. But actually, we know this, but why is it necessary? These students, they have rooms in their homes. They have Wi-Fi in their homes, and they even have beds in their homes. Why do they need the library? The answer is, they are coming to the library. And I heard this from many students and professors. Everybody is coming to the library for protection from information overload. Because if they sit at home, there are so many distractions and interruptions that they can't focus on studying. So they come to the library because it is quiet and because they are not interrupted as much. So in a sense, information overload first pulled them away from the libraries, now it's pushing them back. Another role is, of course, that libraries will continue to need to quietly conserve knowledge. And this is a very heavy responsibility. And I know how it's happening in some libraries I'm acquainted with. Because you can't keep everything, and you can't scan everything, and you can't migrate everything. You have to make the decision what will remain as part of human knowledge, and what will disappear. Like all the stuff that was burned in the library, for example, and will never inhabit. And the problem is that these decisions are heavily cultural and political. And if you look at the library in Alexandria, when you look at that the second time, there is this beautiful story that may or may not be fake, but it's certainly lovely, about the Caliph Omar. That when they came and told him that we conquered the city and let this library full of books, what are we going to do? And he said, if the books are in agreement with the Quran, then we don't need them, so burn them. And if they are not in agreement, then certainly we should burn them. And the point I want to make is, this is not a story like something about how it was barbarian and it was vandalism. Not at all. He didn't say burn the library for fun. He actually thought about it, and he applied an intellectual consideration based on the cultural and religious environment he was in. And in that environment, he was right. Yes, they should have burned it. But he didn't think that maybe in future generations, opinions will change. Maybe people, even Muslim people, are not going to decide that everything should be burned except the Quran. It didn't occur to him. And I think when you make these decisions, it should occur to you to think what future generations will think about not having what you are leaving out. And of course, you should make sure you have the funds for migrating what you do. Otherwise, it's better to keep less and have money to migrate. Oops. In conclusion, I'd like to say this to you. The information explosion is certainly going to continue and accelerate exponentially, and so on. We all know that. But you are uniquely positioned, actually, to help humanity deal with it, to help humanity protect itself from the fake and the overload, and to help it benefit from all this access to information that we never had before. You are really the right people to do this. And I think that if you rise to this opportunity, and by rise I mean to actively take charge of it and lead it, you are going to ensure the continued relevance of libraries for many, many years. Because instead of looking at libraries and saying, yeah, these are the people that give you paper books that you don't need, people are going to say, these are the people that help us cope with information overload, which is a major, major issue in our time. So good luck with that, and interesting notes.